Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Miss Switch to the Rescue by Barbara Brooks Wallace, narrated by Jeff Woodman.
Chapter 1. Two Last Roses of Summer. "Boring," my friend Amelia Daly said. "It sure is," I replied. I was sitting on the floor, propped up against my bed, watching the leafless branches of our oak tree sway mournfully in the fierce February storm. There was just enough light from my room to give them a spooky glow. Swish, swish, swish. A branch scraped across the window like the fingers of an old skeleton. "Boring," repeated Amelia. She was sitting at my desk, staring gloomily at the stump of one of my favorite chewed-up pencils. "Boring, boring," I replied with a deep sigh. We had been pursuing a conversation along these lines for some time, and who knows how much longer it would have continued if my mother hadn't appeared in my room just then. My room, for those of you who may not have read an earlier account of myself, written by me, is actually a very interesting place to be. This is because I've become a great scientist recently, and even though I don't have exactly what you'd call an honest-to-goodness laboratory, I do have a lot of neat scientific stuff in my room. There's my microscope, of course, but I also have a bunch of things I made myself, like containers made from used light bulbs, a graduated cylinder from an olive bottle, and small pans from lids of preserving jars. I even have an alcohol lamp I made from a mustard jar and a tripod that used to be a tomato can. That's to put over the alcohol lamp. Amelia, who has recently become a great scientist herself, thinks all this stuff is pretty nifty too. So you can probably understand that when we were talking about something being boring, it was not my room we were talking about.
"What's wrong with you children?" my mother asked cheerfully. "You look like the two last roses of summer."
I gave my mother a look of disgust. Two last roses of summer. The only correct thing about that statement was the two. Summer ended 6 months ago, and I've never heard of any roses lasting until the middle of February. How unscientific can you get?
"We're just thinking about how boring school is now, Mrs. Brown," said Amelia.
My mother looked surprised.
"Why, how could school be boring when you have as fine a teacher as Mrs. Fitzgerald? I thought you liked her, Rupert."
"Oh, I like her all right. And I guess she's a pretty good teacher,
But she's not Miss Switch," Amelia finished for me.
"Miss Switch?" said my mother dimly. "You mean the Miss Switch who was your teacher for a short time when you started fifth grade last fall?"
"That's the one," I said. My mother was puzzled.
"Well, I know you liked her a great deal, but my goodness, I'm sure she didn't make school any more interesting than Mrs. Fitzgerald."
"Oh?" Amelia and I exchanged raised eyebrow glances. The truth was that no ordinary teacher, no matter how nice she was or how hard she tried, could make school as interesting as Miss Switch. What teacher, for instance, could make a spitball fly back without any visible means of projection and hit the person who sent it? How could an ordinary teacher cause a quarterback and a football to disappear in a football game, making for the most unusual game in history? And most of all, how could any ordinary teacher take you on a broomstick ride, no engine, no batteries, no fooling, to meet with a crazy but scientifically mind-boggling contraption called a computer witch? You can take it from me, Rupert P., for Peevely, though that's not something I care to have generally breezed around, Brown the Third, scientist devoted to truth and accuracy, that's what happened with Miss Switch. Because the fact is that only one side of Miss Switch's nature was that of a teacher. The other side, known only to Amelia and me, was that of a witch. A real one. And naturally, a person who combines all the best qualities of a terrific teacher and a good witch would be pretty impossible to beat. I think you can understand, however, why I couldn't reveal all this to my mother or my father. My father thinks he's a very humorous person, and probably would have come up with a bunch of jokes about the subject, not believing any of it for a moment. My mother would have rushed me off to our doctor for a physical, or loaded me down with vitamin C. My mother has simple remedies for everything. Some of them actually work, but I just don't believe vitamin C is the answer to witchcraft. So Amelia and I said no more as my mother went to the window and peered out.
Brr, it's a nasty night.
That must be why you two are feeling so glum. See here, have you finished your homework for tomorrow? Amelia and I looked at one another again and shrugged. We didn't know what this was leading up to. Then we both nodded. We had finished our homework ages ago.
Good, my mother said. We don't want Amelia getting behind on her work so her parents won't ever let her stay with us again, do we?
Amelia and I shook our heads dutifully. No, we certainly didn't want that. I should explain here that Amelia was spending a few days with us because her mother and father had to make an emergency trip out of town. She slept in the small room down the hall that's our guest room when we have guests, and my mother's sewing room when we don't.
Then why don't you take this hour before bedtime and start on one of your experiments, Rupert? That should cheer you both up.
My mother was really feeling sorry for us. Neither of my parents ever actually suggests that I do an experiment. This is because a lot of them end up looking diseased and disgusting, like my moldy orange experiment, or smelling terrible, like my maggot growing on pork chop experiment, which looks diseased and disgusting besides. Some of them, especially ones involving my mustard jar alcohol burner, my parents seem to think are downright dangerous, as well as smelling terrible. My father says if the smells haven't already driven us out of the house, we'll probably all be blown out someday. He really does think he's funny. At any rate, you can understand my surprise at hearing this suggestion from my mother.
We'll think about it, I replied, and tried to look pleased and grateful.
My mother then left with a cheerful, encouraging, sympathetic, hopeful smile. But as soon as she had disappeared, Amelia and I fell into another gloomy silence.
I just don't feel like doing an experiment, I said.
I don't either, said Amelia.
I wonder why we don't.
Maybe it's because we've suddenly started thinking so hard about Miss Switch.
Maybe you're right. We fell silent again.
Do you suppose it's because she's getting ready to come back? Amelia asked suddenly.
I shook my head.
She said she was never going to, and I believe her.
Well, maybe somebody repaired that dumb old computer witch, and it's sending Miss Switch back here to prove herself as a witch all over again. Did you ever think of that, Rupert P. Brown?
Amelia's brown curls bounced defiantly on her forehead.
She was getting mad at me, as if it was all my fault. Of course I've thought of that.
I got angry, too.
But when I say that the computer witch was wrecked, I mean it was R-U-I-N-E-D wrecked, Amelia M. Daly. And anyway, the only witch who would have wanted to repair it was Saturna, whose idea it was in the first place. Which, in case you've forgotten, is why she was banished from Witch's Mountain. The rest of the witches hated it.
Well then,
Amelia was not going to give up.
Don't you remember that Miss Switch said that sometimes, when the moon is full and the night is clear, we might see a single cloud pass overhead, and that cloud could be her?
What do you mean, don't I remember that?
Gee, Amelia, how many times have we stood gazing up at the moon this winter hoping to see Miss Switch? Once I almost got pneumonia.
That was just a stiff neck, Rupert.
Well, it felt like pneumonia. I wasn't being very scientific, but sometimes when you get pushed too far, you forget yourself.
Anyway, what's that got to do with anything?
What it has to do with, Rupert, is maybe Miss Switch is going to fly over tonight and wants us to be sure and see her.
That would be a very good possibility, except for two things, Amelia.
One, it isn't a clear night. Two, there's no moon. I don't care. I'm gonna look anyway.
Amelia flung herself out of the desk chair and ran to the window.
What could I do but follow? I mean, what if she was right?
We pressed our noses against the cold window pane, staring upward through the weaving oak tree branches into the sky. But it was soon clear that we weren't going to see anything outside my window except bare tree branches dancing spookily in the howling wind and an inky black sky. The closest thing we saw to a moon was the lonely, eerie-looking street lamp at the foot of our driveway.
There, you see, I told you there'd be nothing.
I said it angrily to hide my disappointment. I really had wanted Amelia to be right.
Well?
Amelia was close to tears.
Look, I said quickly, this wasn't such a bad idea. We both know that with witchcraft, lots of weird things are possible. The storm could have suddenly ended, and the moon could have come out. That just didn't happen this time. But we'll see Miss Switch again one day. I know we will.
Amelia gave me a watery smile.
Anyway, I said, why don't we do what Mom suggested? I have this neat experiment I've been wanting to try. Come on.
But Amelia didn't answer. She had her nose pressed up tightly against the window pane again and beckoned to me excitedly.
What is it? Look, Rupert, over there by the juniper bushes beside your driveway, there's a strange shadow, and it just moved.
It's probably just the bushes blowing around in the wind, I said, but I peered out the window anyway. And what I saw, instead of the normal two bushes, was three bushes. Or was it a bush? Amelia and I turned to one another and breathed the words together.
Miss Switch!
But if it is Miss Switch, what would she be doing skulking around our house? I said. I'd think she'd just show up in our classroom the way she did before. Amelia shrugged.
She might be in trouble again and need to see us in a hurry.
Maybe. But what if it isn't Miss Switch? What if it's a burglar looking for a way in? Amelia gasped, and I quickly switched off the lamp so we could see out, but not be seen at the window. We didn't wait long before the third shadow, the one that was not the juniper bush, separated itself from the other two and slithered across the driveway toward our house. This seemed downright slinky and sinister. What should we do? Run down and warn my family? My mind was spinning. And then the doorbell rang.
Now, a burglar doesn't ordinarily ring the doorbell to announce that he's about to rob your house.
On the other hand, the shadow didn't seem to be your normal, everyday kind of visitor. Which could only mean one thing.
It is Miss Switch, cried Amelia. It's gotta be, I said.
We tore from the room and thumped down the stairs. Racing past the living room door, I noticed that my parents were deep in a game of Scrabble, with the stereo turned up full force playing one of my father's favorite operas. The soprano hollering at the top of her lungs had drowned out the sound of the bell, so they hadn't even heard it, nor seen us race by the door. So it was just Amelia and I who threw the door open to greet Miss Switch. Except that it wasn't Miss Switch. Not by a long, long, long shot. My stomach still shrivels up into a cold knot, and my skin prickles with goosebumps even now when I think of the person who was there, standing right outside our doorway. Chapter 2. A Strange Delivery. The person in our doorway was a woman, although it was difficult to tell this at first glance. Her face was hidden deep inside a musty, ancient black cloak, which covered her like a shroud and gave off a curious smell of soot. The light from our doorway, however, was just enough to pick up a huge nose the color of moldy green cheese,
covered wall to wall with the nastiest-looking hairy warts I had ever seen in my life. My most disgusting experiments couldn't have held a candle to that nose. The light also picked up two evil pinpricks of eyes that glittered inside dark, deep sockets, and a mouth spread open, I think this was supposed to represent a friendly smile, to reveal five grim-looking yellow teeth, three above, two below. Altogether, this was not my idea of the kind of person you would want arriving on your doorstep on a dark, moonless night, or a sunny day, either. I grabbed Amelia by the hand. Wait a minute. I'll go tell my mother and father you're here. They'll be glad to see you. Before I'd even finished the sentence, a bony hand flicked out from the cloak and snapped around my arm. Stay! Her voice sounded hot and gravelly, as if it had been filtered through burning charcoal. She removed her hand from around my arm, but very slowly, to let me know she could get it back there again in a hurry. Then she flashed another yellow smile at Amelia and me.
I didn't come to see your parents, Rupert. I came to see you and your little friend Amelia here.
She put her face up close enough to mine that I could feel her hot breath.
I wouldn't run and tell them anything, dearie. Better for you if you don't, eh?
I couldn't agree with her more. I could still feel the effect of that bony hand around my arm, and there was nothing to say I wouldn't feel it around my neck. I confess that I considered hollering, but I wasn't certain I could out-holler the soprano doing her best in our living room. So, being a reasonable fellow, I simply nodded.
Good. I thought you'd see it my way. Anyway, what would be the point of telling your parents anything? I've only come to give you a little present. All children like presents. You'd like a little present, wouldn't you, dearie?
This question was addressed to Amelia, accompanied by another nasty, yellow-toothed leer. Amelia turned to me with eyes the size of large bottle caps, and I gave her a quick nod, letting her know that yes was a safer answer than no. After all, we didn't want to make anyone angry.
Yes.
Amelia's voice was quavering as much as mine.
Splendid, hissed the witch.
Yes, I said witch. I had suspected this from the first, but a scientist does not jump to instant conclusions. I had to feel pretty well convinced before I was ready to reveal this information. She dived inside her cloak and rummaged around for something. Then her bony hand darted out and thrust a tattered package about the size of a shoebox tied with string into my hand. I just stood and stared at it, wondering what we were expected to do next. After all, this was not your normal everyday United parcel delivery.
Should we open it now? I asked.
Oh, no. You take it up to your room, dearies. You can open it there. I expect you to open it there. But I have to warn you about something.
The witch's voice became low and menacing.
Don't show this package or its contents to anyone. Do you hear me? Anyone. It could be very unhealthy for you. I hesitate to tell you how unhealthy. Do I make myself clear?
Boy, did she make herself clear. Yes, I stammered. She rubbed her bony hands together.
Very good. I can see that you are smart children, and that I can trust you not to do anything foolish. Now, run along and enjoy yourselves. And mind what I've said, dearies, eh?
With a wild cackle, she whirled around, her black cloak billowing out like the smoke from a witch's cauldron. A moment later, she had melted into the darkness.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.